Horticulture is the priority sector now. Short-duration crops like banana are occupying more area. Fertilizer-responsive, high-yielding varieties are the first choice of our farmers. Banana is the only major fruit which can be grown and marketed round the year. Apart from the internal production, banana is being imported into Karnataka from all the surrounding states. Banana stands second next to mango in the list of fruits. It is important in our menu as well in the form of fresh fruit, chips, dry fruit, vegetable, etc. Banana fiber for agriculture use, leaves as meal plates, green fodder for cattle and other usages. It is a common natural shade for small areca plants. Banana species originates from Southeast Asia, hence it is seen everywhere in this region. Botanically, banana is a monocot plant. Taxonomically, the edible variety is Musa paradisica. The true stem of the plant is a rhizome in the soil. The upper part is a pseudostem, made up of tight roll of leaf sheets. It has a shallow root system. These are the female flowers in the top hands of the bunch. These are the sterile male flowers at the end. The female flower develops into the fruit without pollination. This process is called parthenocarpy. Banana fruit is useful to reduce the body weight and for easy motion. This is a rich source of nutrients and energy also. Stem sap can stop bleeding and diarrhea. This is useful for the production of permanent ink too. Banana pseudostem is used for the production of fiber, paper, manure, green fodder, etc. Banana is the only food crop giving highest production of 30 to 40 tons per acre, while potato gives 10 tons and rice 4 tons per acre. Banana is a sun-loving plant, but some varieties tolerate shade. Hence, they are seen in mixed plantations with coconut and areca nut palms. However, the high-yielding varieties like Robusta and Cavendish need pure planting. Banana is a tropical plant, growing very well in warm, humid climate. It is successful in the temperature range of 10 to 40 degrees centigrade. It cannot grow below 10 degrees centigrade. Banana performs well from sea level to an elevation of 1,500 meters. It can grow in all types of soil. However, the well-drained red loamy soil is most suitable. It can perform well in medium black soil without waterlogging. Even then, the pest and disease problem is more in black soil. One can take 5 healthy ratoon crops in red soil, while 3 ratoon crops are possible in black soil. Banana can tolerate slightly saline soil and water EC up to 1.5. Since banana is a native plant of this region, hundreds of varieties are seen. Till today, there are no successful hybrids because of some genetical problems and male sterility. Cavendish, Robusta and G-Name are called hybrids in farmers' language, but they are not the hybrids. Instead, they are the selections from the mutants. Many local varieties are popular in different regions for their specific usages. In Malnad regions of Karnataka, Karibale, Bargi and Mitli are common in areca plantations. Shanbale and Kembale are the vegetable types. Wild banana is popular for shade and leaf purposes. Rajapuri in North Karnataka, Kadali and Nendra in South region, Budubale, Sugandhi etc. are the other popular varieties. But the Cavendish types and Yalaki are the only varieties widely accepted in commercial plantations. This is Yalaki Mitli variety. The stem and leaf stalks are pure green. This is the popular variety of hilly regions and South Karnataka. Fruits are small, firm, and the shelf life is more. The plant is too tall and the damage by wind is more. the soft leaves tear off with high velocity wind, affecting the yield. See, this plantation has been destroyed by winds. The farmer lost lakhs of rupees. These plants are bent in the direction of the wind. Hence, support for this Yalaki variety is essential. But this variety tolerates shade, gives good yield in the mixed plantations with coconut and arecanut. Tissue culture multiplication is not yet successful commercially with this variety. Hence, rhizome planting is in practice. Suckers production is more. Yalaki banana is highly susceptible for Panama wilt disease. Harvesting is little bit difficult because of the height. The average weight of the bunch is 10 to 12 kilograms under good management. This variety has better demand in big cities and fetches 12 to 15 rupees per kilogram. Though the yield is half of the robusta variety, it compensates with high price. Hence, the income is the same. The big planters grow both the types in equal proportions. The bigger bunch of Yalaki variety gets more price per kilogram because of the bigger fruit size. Cost of production is the same as that of the robusta variety. This is the mixed plantation of Yalaki variety of banana with the arecanut palm. The bunch is covered with a thick plastic cover to avoid monkeys. This also helps to get clean fruits without any fungal or insect damaged spots. The bunch will mature faster. Since the plant is too high, it is provided with support with a synthetic fiber tied to the areca palm. Here, the average bunch weight is 18 kilograms. The fruit size is excellent, and hence he gets the premium price. Banana has become a commercial crop with the introduction of Cavendish varieties. Popular varieties like Grand Name, Robusta Tall, Williams, etc. are the mutants of Dwarf Cavendish. This is the Dwarf Cavendish, the world popular dwarf variety introduced at first into India. The maximum plant height is 6 feet, which easily escapes wind damage, hence saves the cost on staking. The leaf width is more. This Dwarf Cavendish variety likes dry weather, gives out the bunch by the 8th month and is ready for harvest by the 12th month. The hands are spaced closely. Fruit and the bunch are small and hence the yield is less. Maximum average weight is 20 kilograms under good management. In winter, choking of the bunch is a problem. The fruit remains greenish even after ripening, which loses attraction. Also, the fruits drop from the bunch, which troubles the retailers. Because of all these problems, this Dwarf Cavendish variety is unpopular now. The second introduction is Robusta Tall. It grows to a height of 8 to 9 feet. Though the stem is strong, it needs staking because of the heavy bunches. It flowers by the 8th month and is ready for harvest by the 12th month. The bunch and the fruit size is more compared to the G name. Matured fruit is round without edges. The ripened fruit has an attractive color. The individual fruit weighs around 200 to 300 grams, which often troubles the retailer. The problem of the fruits dropping once ripened is seen to some extent. The average weight of the bunch is 35 to 40 kilograms under good management. One more similar variety called Williams is becoming popular, which can give still bigger bunches and more yield. But the big bunch and fruits are disliked by most of the retailers. This is the most popular variety, Grand Nain or G Nain from Israel. Plant height is medium and hence wind lodging is less. But still, the plant with heavy bunch needs staking. Fruits, bunch size and yield are medium. Ripened fruit color is quite attractive and no problem of fruit drop from the bunch. The fruit has three edges. The shelf life of the ripened fruit is more in comparison to the other varieties. This variety is a selection overcoming the problems of Robusta Tall and other varieties. Conventionally, banana propagation is by suckers or rhizomes. But in recent years, the tissue culture plants are becoming popular. Suckers selected from pest and disease-free plantations also give good yield. TC plants have no special capacity to give extraordinary yield. Select this type of sward suckers for planting. This originates from the bottom of the rhizome of the mother plant. This grows healthy and fruiting is fast. This type of water sucker is not suitable. It grows slow and flowers late. Traditional farmers plant the suckers as it is, like this, which is not correct. Instead, cut off the stem and plant only the rhizome part. This gives out strong and healthy sprout. It is difficult to get healthy suckers of required variety in large numbers. If the sucker is separated from the cropping plant itself, it affects the yield. Also, the pest and disease may enter from the wound. So, take out the suckers only after the harvest of the crop. Panama wilt and bunchy top diseases, rhizome weevil, nematodes spread with the affected sucker. Hence, select the sucker if and only if the plantation is free from all these problems. It is very difficult and costly to get rid of these pests and diseases if once they enter the garden. Because of all of these problems, now the tissue culture plants are popular. Most of the TC laboratories multiply only Cavendish varieties. Because of the problem of variation in the characters, TC multiplication in Yalaki and many other varieties are not yet successful commercially. The rhizome costs around 3 to 5 rupees. This ready-to-plant TC plant costs 12 to 15 rupees. Tissue of a model plant of the required variety from a healthy plantation is collected for tissue culture multiplication. It is cultured in a high-tech laboratory to produce plants. This is a very sensitive and costly process. Generally, the TC plants are free from diseases. But if infected tissue is selected by mistake, the whole stock of plant goes to waste. Sometimes the variation in the TC plants affects the crop growth and the yield. Hence, purchase the TC plants from well-known and responsible laboratories or hardening nurseries. Generally, the TC plants are uniform in growth and the harvest completes in a short span. This is helpful for transportation and marketing. The bunches and fruits also show uniformity. If rhizomes of the same size are planted, they also give uniform crop but not equal to the TC plants. TC plants can give 5 healthy ratoon crops, while the sucker plantation can continue for 2 ratoon crop. However, the management is the same. These are the miniature plants from the TC labs. They are being raised in net pots carefully. These poly tunnels provide high temperature and humidity. After 25 to 30 days, they are transferred to the poly bags filled with soil, sand and manure. Fertilizers, fungicides, insecticides and growth regulators are sprayed from time to time. This stage is called hardening. It needs this kind of a closed shade house. These plants are 3 months old and are ready for planting. Healthy and sturdy plants are selected from the lots and sold to the farmers for 10 to 15 rupees. It can be transported to any distance. Plough the land in both directions. Leave it in the open sun for 2 months, which kills the pests and disease-causing organisms. Growing sun hemp and mixing with soil is also recommended. Put at least 10 tons of farm yard manure at the time of ploughing. Even in pits, mix the manure with the soil. Not put directly to the plant base, which otherwise may cause fungal infection. Supply of organic manure is compulsory for the healthy growth of banana plants. It is better to dig a trench of 1.5 feet in depth with an MB plough in bigger plots than digging individual pits. In case of manual digging, let the pit size be 1.5 cubic feet. Mix 5 ml of chlorpyrifos, 3 grams of COC, 50 grams of DAP, in 1 litre of water. Drench 200 ml of this solution to each pit. Put 10 grams of 4-8 granules also. These are necessary for the control of soil-borne pests and diseases. The common spacing for banana is 6 into 6 feet or 7 into 5 feet. This accommodates around 1,200 plants per acre. In high density planting, 4 into 4 feet or 5 into 5 feet spacing is followed. Recently, the double row planting has been becoming popular. The wider space here is helpful for better light and air penetration, intercultivation, fertilizer application, irrigation, etc. The farmer's experience says that the double row spacing of 4 into 4 feet in pair rows and 8 feet between two pair rows is good. It accommodates around 1,675 plants per acre. Few intensive farmers even follow the closest spacing of 7 into 4 into 3.5, 7 into 4 into 4, or 8 into 4 into 3 feet for genane. They plant around 2,500 plants and get the highest yield of 60 tons per acre. Triangular alignment of plants in rows is better. In these kinds of high-density plantations, the nutrient management schedule should be followed strictly. Select the rhizomes for planting from a healthy plantation of first crop. This gives vigorous and healthy sprouts. It is better if it is of TC plants, which will have less pest and disease infestation. Grade the rhizome as big, medium, and small based on the size. Plant them in separate rows and sections. Small rhizomes are also suitable for planting, but it must have at least 1.5 kilograms weight. If you plant all sizes in a mixture, weak sprouts from small rhizomes will suffer and fail to grow in the shade. Remove all old roots with a thin layer of skin like this. Old roots carry the infection of diseases and nematodes. Mix 4 kg of DAP, 600 g of mancozeb, 500 ml of chlorpyrifos into 200 liters of cow dung slurry. Dip and take out the rhizomes in the mixture. Smear 10 grams of 4-8 granules on each rhizome. All these chemicals together will prevent rhizome weevil, stem borer, thrips, nematodes, termites, and Panama wilt disease. Dry these rhizomes under the shade for 1 day and then plant. Plant this rhizome in an inverted position like this when the climate is hot. This helps to get out stout and vigorous sprouts. Retain the sprouts of uniform size in all pits and remove the remaining ones. In the cold season, do not go for inverted planting, which may result in poor sprouting. In the case of tissue culture plants, planting is very easy. Simply cut off the poly bag and plant. We can take up banana planting in all the seasons. This fruit has good demand throughout the year, but avoid the full crop in May-June. Otherwise, the strong monsoon wind may destroy the heavy plants. It is better to have live windbreakers like Susbania, Glericeria, etc. around the plantation. This minimizes the uprooting of plants and tearing out of the leaves. Banana, being a succulent plant, needs assured irrigation. Hence, avoid fully grown crop in April-May months in water-scarce areas. The demand and the price of banana remain almost the same in all the seasons, with minor variations. Banana is a short-duration plantation crop. Flower primordial initiates at 5th to 6th month stage in short-duration varieties. Hence, by that time, the absorption of necessary nutrients should complete. Otherwise, it will affect the yield. So, the slow-releasing manures and fertilizers are not effective. Hence, the organic manure is applied before planting itself. Fertilizer must be of water-soluble type. Finish the soil application of fertilizers by 7th month. Remaining doses, if any, are by foliar sprays. The roots spread in all directions up to 3 feet in the upper layer of the soil. Put the fertilizers in a shallow ring, 1 foot away from the plant base. Cover it again with soil. Maintain enough moisture to facilitate its absorption. Otherwise, dissolve the granules in water and drench. Giving water-soluble fertilizers through drip irrigation system is the best method. It is difficult to adopt complete organic farming in these kinds of heavy feeding, fast growing, high yielding crops and varieties. In fertile virgin soils and soil with heavy organic matter, the organic cultivation may give good crop. Long duration local varieties are suitable for organic farming. Few farmers take ratoon crops without any fertilizers. Nutrient requirement of banana is like this. Nitrogen 216 kg, phosphorus 130 kg and potash 270 kg per acre. In other words, 1.5 kg of NPK and 200 grams of micronutrient per plant is necessary. To avoid confusion in various spacing, nutrients are calculated on per plant basis. In acidic soils of heavy rainfall areas, use 0.5 kg of lime per plant. And here, the rock phosphate is better for phosphorus supply. In alkaline soils, ammonium sulfate, single superphosphate and DAP are recommended. Decide the type and amount of fertilizer depending on the soil test report. Nutrient requirement varies even with varieties. Hence, the general recommendation is difficult in banana. Complete the fertilizer application in 7 months in monthly doses. Weekly installments are still better. This minimizes the wastage and gives better growth. Put the fertilizer in a ring, 1 foot away from the plant base, and cover with soil. If left uncovered, evaporation loss will be more. Now let us study the fertilizer recommendation for banana in acidic soils of heavy rainfall area. Dosage per plant is given. SSP means single superphosphate. MOP means muriate of potash. The dose is the same for both sucker and TC plants. Let us study the different doses now. At the time of planting, 75 grams of SSP and 600 grams of rock phosphate. 30 days stage, 50 grams of urea and 50 grams of MOP. 75 days stage, 90 grams of urea, 50 grams of DAP, 75 grams of SSP and 85 grams of MOP. 110 days stage, 115 grams of urea, 50 grams of DAP and 85 grams of MOP. 150 days stage, 100 grams of urea and 100 grams of MOP. 180 days stage, 90 grams of urea and 100 grams of MOP. Flower emerging stage, 100 grams of MOP. Note that the phosphorus dose completes before the 4th month. No nitrogen is given after flowering. Later on, supply any nutrient by foliar spray if necessary. These recommendations apply for both Yalaki and Robusta varieties of banana. Now let us go through the fertilizer dose followed by North Karnataka farmers. 15 days after planting, 50 grams of 19-19-19 complex. 30 day stage, 100 grams of 19-19-19, 50 grams of zinc sulfate, and 25 grams of magnesium sulfate. More doses of micronutrients are given through foliar sprays if the deficiency is noticed. 45-day stage, 150 grams of 19-19-19 complex. 75-day stage, 200 grams of ammonium sulfate, 200 grams of SSP, and 100 grams of MOP. Repeat the same dose at 110 days and 150 days also. At 180 day stage, give only 100 grams of MOP. By this time, flower primordia initiates inside. Finish the soil application of nutrients at this stage. Spray a solution of 2 grams of calcium nitrate and 1 gram of water-soluble boron in 1 liter of water to the newly emerged bunches. After 10 days, spray a solution of 2 grams of magnesium nitrate and 1 gram of boron in 1 liter of water. Now, let us go through the fertilizer dosage followed by the South Karnataka farmers. They mix equal quantities of DAP, urea and MOP instead of complex fertilizers, which saves the cost. At the time of planting, 50 grams of DAP and 10 grams of 4-8 insecticide. At sprouting stage, 50 grams of earlier mentioned mixture and 10 grams of 4-8. Second and third month stage, 300 grams of the same mixture and 10 grams of 4-8. Fourth month stage, 100 grams of urea, 100 grams of MOP and 10 grams of 4-8. Fifth, sixth and seventh month stage, 100 grams of urea and 100 grams of MOP. This completes the soil application with 1.5 kilograms of fertilizer and 40 grams of 4-8. Micronutrient mixture is prepared by mixing 1 kg of zinc sulfate, 2 kg of magnesium sulfate, 2 kg of ferrous sulfate, and 50 grams of copper sulfate powder. Give 100 grams of this mixture with the last fertilizer dose and one more dose after 1 month. Later on, give foliar sprays for any deficiency. Putting 4-8 is to avoid rhizome weevil, stem borer, and nematodes. It works for 6 months. Hence, do not apply 4-8 after 4 months of planting. Cut off the male flower navel at 4 inches length after all the finger hands complete. This saves the nutrient wastage. Mix 1 kg of 19-19-19 complex, 4 kg of potassium nitrate and 200 ml of spic cytozyme in 200 liters of water. Spray this solution to the bunch twice in 1 month interval. This produces the healthy and bigger fruits in the bunch. Indian Institute of Horticulture Research, Bengaluru has developed a micronutrient mixture called Banana Special. There are few formulations of private companies for the purpose available in the market. Recommendation of Banana Special is like this. Dissolve 125 grams of the same in 25 liters of water along with one shampoo sachet and lemon juice from one big lemon fruit. Use this solution for foliar spray at 5th, 6th, 7th and 8th month stage. Spray the same to the bunch also. This solution is compatible with any insecticide and fungicide. Take the foliar sprays between 6 a.m. and 11 a.m. or 4 p.m. and 6:30 p.m. for maximum absorption. Spray the liquid to the lower surface of the leaves where maximum number of stomata are situated. Adding shampoo improves the spreading of the spray liquid while the lemon juice corrects the pH of the solution. Hence, these two are important. Soil application of micronutrient is not necessary if these foliar sprays are given. Remember, any chemical solution should not be kept for a long time. Spray fresh solutions only. According to the researchers, the foliar sprays are effective than soil application. It takes 15 to 20 days for absorption from the soil, while it needs 1 or 2 days with a foliar spray. The plant utilizes hardly 3 to 5% of the nutrients applied to the soil, while it is 30 to 40% in foliar spray. Hence, the foliar spray saves the cost but gives better yield. Even the ratoon crops will give same yield if the foliar sprays are followed. In acidic and alkaline soils, the fertilizer applied to the soil becomes unavailable for the plants. In such cases, the foliar spray is the most effective solution. Now, let us study the micronutrient deficiency symptoms in banana. This plant is deficient with nitrogen. The leaves are clubbed together like an umbrella. Leaves have lost their green luster. This is phosphorus deficiency. The leaves have turned dark green. The leaves of these big plants have dead tissues. This plant is deficient with potash. Leaves are turning yellow and tips are drying. In the next stage, the entire leaf dries up and midrib bends down. Pseudostem tissue decays and makes space for the entry of the stem borer. This is a cross-section photo of the stem. This is calcium deficiency symptom. The suckers have dried up even though the main plant is healthy. This plant is deficient with magnesium. The leaf edge has a yellow strip. This shows the extreme deficiency where the chlorophyll is missing. This plant shows the scars of dead tissue. This pseudostem is split open. This is sulfur deficiency. The upper surface of the leaves has a silver shine. These plants show yellowing due to zinc deficiency. These are the big plants with the same problem. This is boron deficiency symptom. Typical yellowing with swollen leaf veins. Folded young leaf is twisted. Foliar sprays can correct all these deficiency symptoms. Farmers having good water source go for flooding of banana. This is not a good practice. Panama disease may spread. Apart from the wastage of water, weeds also grow profusely. Hence, the drip irrigation is the best method. It saves the water and enables fertigation. In high-density plantation, mini and micro sprinklers are becoming popular. Each banana plant needs 15 to 30 liters of water every day. Weed problem is more in the early stage. Short duration intercrops will avoid the weeds with additional income. Dicot crops will improve fertility. Some farmers grow commercial crops like patchouli. The weedicides like alachlore, diuron, etc. are recommended. But hand weeding is safe. In paired row systems, intercultivation with mini tillers is possible. Some farmers practice earthing up. This gives support to the plant base along with weed control. Suckers grow in large numbers around the plant base. If they are not controlled, the wastage of nutrients affects the yield. Allow only one sword sucker to grow on the opposite side of the bunch, where the flower bunch comes out. But in this kind of high-density plantations, suckers are allowed only after the harvest of the crop. Otherwise, the thick shade will not allow the sucker to grow healthy. Control the sucker from time to time. It is major management work in banana plantations. Cut the sucker with a sickle and damage the remaining base with a stick. Even few drops of kerosene on the cut part can control the growth effectively. In case of the tall varieties, the plant needs staking to avoid breaking of the stem. Bamboo support is common but costly. Most of these sticks are not useful for the second crop. The genane crop with wide spacing also needs staking. In high-density planting, synthetic packing tapes are tied to a peg like this on the opposite side of the bunch. This works out very cheap. In mixed plantations, this kind of support with fiber is sufficient. Traditionally, replanting of banana is not in practice. It continues its generation with suckers. But in commercial plantations, having control on the plant population is necessary. 3 to 5 ratoon crops are possible in healthy and well-maintained plantations. Do not fell the mother plant after the harvest of the bunch. Chaff the leaves and retain the pseudostem. reabsorption of nutrients takes place from this stem, which helps for the growth of the sucker. Few farmers allow one sucker once in 3 to 4 months to harvest 2 to 3 crops in a year. This is advisable only in wider spacing. Even then, the average weight of the bunch drops. Hence, one crop per year is the best practice. Now, let us study the major diseases of banana. The first one is Panama wilt. The causal organism is a soil-borne fungus, Fusarium oxysporum. Pathogen enters the plant through the wounds on the roots. These Yalaki banana plants are affected with Panama wilt. Leaves droop down with yellowing. The plants wilt slowly and die. Cross-section of the stem shows this kind of black-brown rings. The pathogen develops in the stem and hinders the movement of water and nutrients. As a result, the plant wilts. High concentration of pathogen results in the splitting of the stem like this. The fingers of the bunch will not mature in the infected plant. Disease spreads to the suckers also. This is a major worldwide disease of banana. Pathogen lives in the soil for a long time. Other related species of banana and grass roots are the alternate hosts of the fungus. Flooding will spread the disease to the entire garden. The infected rhizome will carry the disease to new plantations. Panama wilt is a reason for the disappearance of Nanjanagudu Rasabale, a historical variety of Karnataka. Yalaki variety is more susceptible. The Cavendish varieties are resistant and will grow unaffected in the infected areas. Uproot the affected plants with rhizome and destroy it away from the garden. Treat the leftover pit with lime and sulfur to bring down the pathogen population. Adding sugarcane trash and urea helps reduce the fungus in the soil. Select the rhizome for planting from disease-free plantations. Crop rotation with unrelated crop after 2 to 3 crops of banana is recommended. Put 1 gram of carbon diazem in 1 liter of water. Dip the rhizomes in the solution before planting. Mix 2 kilograms of trichoderma with 100 kilograms of neem cake and apply 1 to 2 kilograms to each plant. If the disease enters the garden, drench 5 liters of 0.1% Bavistine solution to each plant. Treat all the plants with the affected ones. Controlling this Panama wilt is very difficult and costly if once it enters the garden. Hence, take precaution to avoid this disease. Another major disease of banana is Sigatoka leaf spot. This is also a worldwide disease. Cavendish types are more susceptible. Streaks of this kind will appear on the leaves initially. Then it turns into blotches and spreads to the entire leaf surface. In severe case of infection, the leaf dries up. Normally, the plant will not die, but the yield drops drastically. This fungus is common on older leaves. If it spreads to the upper younger leaves, it will cause serious loss. The fingers of the affected plant will not mature. 23 to 25 degrees centigrade temperature with frequent rain will help the multiplication of the fungal spores and spreading of the disease. Dry weather and high temperature will avoid this disease. Air spreads the fungal spores. Cut off the infected leaves and burn. Avoid excess irrigation and ill drainage. Keep the weeds under control. Spray the leaves with a solution of 1 gram Bavistine or 3 grams of COC in 1 liter of water. Bordeaux mixture of 1% or diethane Z78 solution of 0.25% is also effective. Latest report says that a solution of 0.5 ml tilt in 1 liter of water is most effective. One more major disease of banana is bunchy top. This is a viral disease spread by an aphid. Affected plant will survive for many years like this. If the big plant gets the infection, the bunch will not mature. The disease spreads and causes heavy loss once it enters the garden. The virus cannot survive in the soil, It multiplies in the entire plant in the sap. It spreads with the sickle and other implements also. Canna, turmeric, ginger and cardamom are the alternate host plants of this virus. There is no medicine for the control of this bunchy top disease. No variety is resistant against this virus. Select the sucker from the disease-free garden. Uproot and destroy the plant showing the disease symptoms immediately. Spray the insecticide for the control of the vector aphid. Avoid the alternate host plants. This bunchy top disease is also a major worldwide disease. Prevention is the only solution. Now, let us study the insect pests of banana. The major one is the rhizome weevil. This is also a pest seen worldwide. All the varieties are susceptible for this insect. See, the insect larvae made tunnels in this rhizome. The root grubs and pathogenic fungi enter the plant through these holes. Affected plant shows stunted growth. Leaves show yellowing and the plant may dry up. The fingers in the bunch will not grow and lose market value. These adult weevils cannot fly for long distances and will not drill the rhizome. They hide under moist materials in the daytime and are active during night hours. The female weevil lay eggs on the rhizomes at the soil level throughout the year. Life cycle of this insect is 3 months. The weevils enter the new garden with the rhizomes. Hence, select the suckers from the weevil-free plantation. The problem is severe in waterlogged gardens. Hence, drain the excess water. Destroy the adult weevils manually from their hideouts. Uproot the affected rhizomes and destroy at a distance. Dip the rhizomes in 0.1% chlorpyrifos solution before planting. Smear the 4-8 granules on the rhizomes. Put 10 grams of 4-8 per plant for 4 months. All these measures together will control the rhizome weevil effectively. These are the larvae of the stem borer. See how active they are? Stem borer results in the breaking down of the pseudostem. The control measures taken for the rhizome weevil will avoid this insect also. Nematode is one more pest of banana. These are the minute worms seen in most of the soils. Nematodes spread with old roots of the suckers to the new gardens. The blotch and the knot on this root are the symptoms of the presence of nematode. It scrapes the roots. This wound will help the fungi to enter the root. Thus, the root decays and dries up. This affects the nutrient uptake. The nematode-affected plant shows stunted growth and hence the small finger and bunch. Nematode problem intensifies in ratoon crops. Select nematode-free suckers for planting. Dip the rhizome in warm water of 55 degrees centigrade temperature for 20 to 25 minutes before planting. Remove all old roots on the rhizome. Use 1/2 kilogram of neem cake per plant. Put recommended dose of 4-8. All these measures together will control the nematode. The direct sun on the bunch will create sunburn like this. The bunch will lose the market value. To avoid this, protect the bunch with dry leaves. For the monkey problem, chasing them away is the only solution. This farmer has put a net all along the borders of the garden like this. It could avoid the monkeys to a greater extent. Bunch matures after 4 months of emergence. The leaves turn yellow. Edges on the fruit disappear. Fruit turns light green from dark green. Dry remnants of the flower at the end of the fruit drops by touching. Harvest at full maturity for local market. However, over-ripening splits the fruit like this. Harvest little early for long distance markets. Banana ripens fast at 32 to 35 degrees centigrade. On the other hand, it keeps for long time at 16 to 18 degrees centigrade temperature. The average bunch weight of Yalaki variety is 10 to 12 kilograms. The best average will be 15 kilograms. 15 to 18 tons per acre is the good yield. In case of Robusta and Genane varieties, average weight of the bunch is 20 to 25 kilograms. The best average will be 35 kilograms. 30 to 35 tons per acre is the good yield. Some farmers achieve the highest yield of 60 tons per acre with 2,500 plants in high density planting. Cost of production of the first crop is around 50 to 60,000 rupees per acre. Ratoon crop needs 35 to 45,000 rupees per acre. Absolutely, there is no market problem for banana. Private traders, Hopcoms and Suffol are the major buyers. Banana crop is profitable if Genane variety gets 4 rupees and Yalaki variety gets 10 rupees per kilogram. Now let us study the benefits from the government for banana crop. State Department of Horticulture under National Horticulture Mission Scheme gives 6,000 rupees for 1 acre banana planting. Drip irrigation subsidy is 15,000 rupees per acre. There is no condition of compulsory loan for this. Subsidy per farmer is for a maximum of 5 hectares. One may apply for a subsidy even after planting. The central government under National Horticulture Board scheme provides subsidy. The project cost of 1 acre banana crop is fixed at 1,25,000 rupees. The subsidy is 20% of the total project cost. But the farmer must borrow at least 25% loan from the bank. One should get the letter of intent from NHB well before getting a loan and planting. Subsidy is available for any number of acres per farmer, but the maximum limit of subsidy per farmer is 25 lakh rupees. Farmers can get subsidy for a plantation either from NHB or from NHM. The subsidy is not available for banana mixed crop in any of the schemes. All of us know the multiple usages of banana fruit. Even the dry fruit is produced out of it. Open the fresh fruit and cut it into small pieces. Dry the same under sun or in a dryer. This is quite tasty, but this new product is not yet popular. Production of banana chips is the age-old practice. Karnataka imports banana from all surrounding states, apart from its internal production. This shows the opportunity for the farmers to go for the banana crop. Maharashtra is far ahead in banana production technology. Karnataka is no way less in the resources. Let us hope that the farmers of Karnataka will utilize this opportunity for banana cultivation in the coming years.